Hi, welcome to our online college workshop. My name's Danny. I'm one of the founders of Game Theory College Planners, and I've been working here with families in the Atlanta area for over 10 years. And what we're going to teach you today is we're going to teach you about enrollment management, and we're going to have a little fun on the way. So a few house rules before we get started. There should be a PDF document, a little welcome packet that you could download. And in that packet are a few things I want you to see. The first thing I want to go over in that packet are two definitions. The first definition I want to go over with you is cost of attendance. This is the advertised price of going to the college. It's not just tuition, it's everything. So everything for the dorms, to the lab fees, to the meal plan, it's all included in that number. So it's important to understand how much a college really costs. The other definition I want to go over with you is EFC, or expected family contribution. This is going to be changing a little bit in a couple of years. They're changing the expected family contribution to the student aid index. At the end of the day, it's still a number that the government and the college expects you to pay. It's important to know these two definitions, because when you put these two numbers together, as a family, it goes a long way in helping you understand how much money you're going to get from a college and what kind of money you'll get from a college. So we'll dive into that a little later. So there's a download link that I want you to know about. You can download all these slides that I'm showing you today. You could download some of the articles that I'm also referencing. And for those of you that really enjoyed this presentation, and if you have a family member or friend that you think should see all the things that we talked about today, shoot me an email. My email address is also on the packet. Just shoot me an email and I'll send you a link to this recording, okay? So let's get started. Oh, again, I'm super easy to find online, okay? I'm not some fly-by-night operator. I live here in the Atlanta area. I'm actually recording this presentation from my kitchen, among other spots you might recognize. So everything you need to learn about us, you'll see, whether it's in our Google reviews, Facebook reviews, or our vlog on YouTube, our podcasts, or our website. Everything you need to know about us is out there. And if you do want to learn more, shoot me an email. So in this class, we're just going to do a shorter version of this class online, and we're going to talk about how much college really costs. We're going to talk about how colleges pick students, and we're going to show you how we help families pay for college, all right? We're going to dive a little bit into social media. Here's why. Number one, you're going to be astonished at how much social media has changed the way you need to apply to college, and it's changed the way how you get money from a college. What's equally astonishing is how many college planners and admissions counselors don't even know this, or don't even go nowhere near social media. So we're going to cover some broad concepts that we think you need to know about. Like I said earlier, we're going to teach you a lot about enrollment management. This isn't the typical college planning class that you've seen. We're not really going to cover admissions counseling. We're going to cover enrollment management, and we're going to go over case studies and show you families that we worked with here locally and talk about them, so you can have a really good grasp of how enrollment management actually works in the real world. One last thing, stay for the whole thing. We'll give you a link where you can sign up for a no-cost FAFSA review. I know this doesn't really mean a lot to you right now, but I think about 20 to 30 minutes in this presentation, you're gonna start to realize how important and how big of an opportunity this is. So stay for the whole thing and you'll be eligible for a no-cost FAFSA review, and we'll show you how to take advantage of that at the end of our little workshop. So let's go ahead and get started. I think we all know that college is expensive no matter where you go, all right? And unless you've been living under a rock, you also know that these prices have been going up drastically. And here are some of the averages according to the College Board. Public four-year in-state colleges in the mid to high 20s, I think that's spot on. Their public four-year out-of-state number, that's about right too. The private school average just seems a little low. A lot of the private schools I see are in the $60,000 to $70,000 a year range, with elite private schools topping out at closer to $80,000 per year. So I don't know, that private school average looks a little low to me. And I pulled these numbers that you're looking at here from an award letter from one of my students that got in the UGA. And as you can see, with the cost of attendance in the high 20s, even though the student's being awarded $7,600 in Hope scholarship money, they're still having to pay out of pocket just a little over $20,000 a year. So here are some college costs for some colleges that you may be aware of. Wake Forest at Emory in the 70s. You've got your Ivies all pushing $80,000 there. So let's change gears. This is gonna hopefully teach you to look at college from a different perspective. What do you think is the single best way to minimize your college expense? And the answer is gonna surprise you. All you've gotta do is graduate on time. Graduate in 4 years like you're supposed to. If you do that one single thing, you're gonna save so much money. A lot of people think I'm joking when I say this, but let's just dig into the numbers a little bit here. So out of 580 public colleges, only 50 of them graduate at least half of their students in 4 years or on time. So let's look at some four-year grad rates at some colleges that you probably know about. Michigan State's only 48%. We have Iowa at 44%, NC State at 41%, Auburn, 36% is the four-year grad rate. University of Arizona, 34%. So as you can see, graduating on time is a challenge. And these are numbers I pulled from a site called Complete College America. And this is a nonprofit run basically by people that work in the education system. There is a general consensus. I'm not even presenting a dissenting or rogue opinion here. But the consensus is that colleges have a tough time graduating their students on time. And if you look at the Chronicle of Higher Education, 18.4 students out of 100 will finish in the public university system of Georgia. So from families here local to the Atlanta area, the in-state option we might think is cheaper might actually cost more, okay? We have to start looking at this from the standpoint of not necessarily how much does it cost to go to college. We have to ask ourselves, how much does it cost to graduate from that college? Okay, two completely different viewpoints here. And it looks like the four-year average of all the colleges in Georgia, only 27.6% will graduate in 4 years. So something to think about. And it's a challenge that a lot of people just don't see coming. And in addition to losing the Hope Scholarship in year five, because the Hope Scholarship only pays for 4 years, a student that takes longer than 4 years to graduate also loses a full year of income because they're still in school and they're not in the workforce. So when you add those two costs together, one extra year costs as much as your first 4 years of college if you're going in state with the Hope Scholarship. So I'm not kidding when I say this. As long as you focus on graduating on time, you're gonna save a ton of money. So these economists at the Federal Reserve, they did their calculations. It's pretty astonishing. They say that if you graduate in six instead of four, you reduce the return of investment on your degree by almost half at 40%. So definitely something to think about. Another challenge facing students here in the state of Georgia is hope retention. So hope retention, it's a number that's very hard to find. And the Red and Black in Athens, Georgia did some research on this and they pegged UGA's hope retention at only 38.8%. So less than 40% of students at UGA, our flagship university, will actually keep the Hope Scholarship for all 4 years. Challenging grad rates, a scholarship that doesn't pay for much, and a scholarship that a lot of students don't even keep. I don't know if in-state with the Hope Scholarship is your least expensive option to graduate. Remember, it's not about how much does it cost to go in-state, because that number looks very attractive. It's about how much does it cost to graduate? And the cost of graduating from an in-state school in Georgia looks like a very expensive number. If you research this, this is a great article at US News and World Report. Oftentimes, the more expensive private colleges can cost the same or less than an in-state college. So something to think about. So changing gears, we're going to talk a little bit about social media and how it has drastically changed how you apply for college and how you get financial aid. So one of my teammates was actually interviewed by the Harvard Crimson, and what came out of that interview was that the Dean of Admissions said that they definitely look at social media. And the only thing I have to say about that is, if Harvard's doing it, I'm pretty sure everybody else is doing it. According to the AACRAO, I'll do my best here. That's the American Association of Collegiate Registrars and Admissions Officers. That over 75% of colleges monitor social media as part of the merit aid and admissions decisions process. So let's just say that a lot of colleges are definitely looking. This is a great chart because it really talks about all the logos that are actually running college admissions today. There's three things: big data, predictive analytics, and artificial intelligence that's really dominating the admissions process. What this basically means is when you submit your college application, it's not necessarily a person that's looking at your application. It's a computer. And there's a lot of predictive modeling that's happening behind the scenes. If you look at this, here's an example of one of the logos I showed you. This is OddHot. They have a data dashboard. They're monitoring a student's activities, a family's activities online, just to generate two very important metrics: affinity index and likelihood to enroll. These metrics are just as essential as a test score, and it's really important to understand that what you're doing online and how you present yourself online has a tremendous impact. So what are universities looking for? What do they want? I mean, we've heard all these things before: grades, test scores, essay, extracurriculars. But I'm gonna talk about the things that you might not know about. One of the top things the college wants is they want as much of your money as possible. And if you don't know what you're doing, they're going to get every penny of it. Colleges, I think as we know, really put a lot of emphasis on test scores. I know COVID-19's kind of thrown that off a little bit, but testing for the SAT and ACT has started to ramp up again. But what I can tell you is that test scores, even for schools that say they're test optional, students with test scores will always have an edge over students that don't. Colleges want money, they want test scores, and they want zip codes. These are things that probably drive the rankings of the college more than any other metrics that are out there. So it's important to recognize that. So we talked a little bit about how colleges pick students and what colleges are looking for, but how do we pick colleges? So I don't know if you've ever sent a student to college before, but the thing you need to understand is when you start filling out the application, when you start filing the FAFSA and these other financial aid forms, it's safe to say that colleges are definitely looking into you, okay? The question is, are we looking into the colleges the same way? And I think we should, and we should start by asking questions like these. These are just five of the numerous questions you should be asking. I wanted to keep this presentation short, so I just limited this list to what I feel are the five top questions you should ask. Other than test score, what admissions criteria is that particular college looking for? Are they looking for more students of your ethnicity? Are they looking for more students, like I said earlier, from your zip code? Are they looking for students with your major, right? And it's worth asking this question because the answers to this question can change from week to week. And how are these criteria ranked in order of importance? How many of your students graduate in 4 years? I know we talked about this, but it's worth repeating. And here's the thing, colleges like the quote grad rate, right? When they don't put a number in front of grad rate, they're giving you their 6-year rate. So when you ask for a college's grad rate, you want to know what their 4-year grad rate is. How many of your freshmen come back? This is what's known as retention rate. I like colleges where 80% or more of their students come back after freshman year. I'll go a little lower, but I really wouldn't look at colleges that are less than 70% retention. That's kind of a red flag in my book. One of my favorites, what is your enrollment yield? Enrollment yield's fantastic. This is basically the percentage of students that are accepted that actually say yes and go to the college. And you would be astonished at how low the enrollment yields actually are at a lot of elite level colleges. I believe Wake Forest and Emory have enrollment yields that are just 29 to 30%. So out of 100 acceptances, only 29 to 30% of the students say yes. So why is this metric so important? You have to understand that colleges with enrollment yields like that fill their seats the same way airlines do, by offering tremendous discounts. So if you know a college's enrollment yield, that will give you a lot of insight as to which colleges pay the bigger merit scholarships, and in some cases, which colleges will negotiate the award letter with you. So yes, you probably didn't know this, but you can actually negotiate the award letter with a lot of colleges. So enrollment yield, find out what it is. Let's recap a few things, a few rules of thumb here. You have to understand that when it comes to college, this is going to be one of the largest purchases you're going to make as a family. So do some research. And by coming to this online class, that's definitely a step in the right direction. You want to shop around. And there's no substitute for a visit. I know visits were a challenge and continue to be a challenge under the COVID-19 environment that we're in. But a lot of schools are opening back up and allowing visits. There's a lot that you can even learn about a college through their social media outlets as well. There's no substitute for a visit. Shop around and do what we do. Take a top-down approach. Instead of starting with one or two colleges, start with all of them. Like I said, that's what we do. Start with all the colleges, narrow it down to the colleges that have your majors, and then narrow it down to the colleges that you'll get into, fit into, and get paid to go to. And out of those, we think you should apply to a minimum of 6 to 10 colleges. Here's why. That's the magic number you should apply to, so you can create the right amount of competition between the colleges. Here's why this is important. When colleges see that they're competing for your student, that's where the merit aid comes from, okay? By creating competition, you significantly increase the amount of merit aid your student gets. Instead of thinking from the standpoint that it's you and your student that's shopping for college, don't look at it that way. I think it's the colleges that are shopping for your student. And when you start looking at it from that standpoint, you could change everything. Now it's time for the main event. I think this is what y'all came here for, is how are families supposed to pay for all of this? We're taught to believe that there's need aid and that there's merit aid. The truth is, there's a lot of kind of aid that's out there, and that's paid for a lot of different reasons. So this is a formula everybody needs to know, regardless of what your income is. So every college has a cost of attendance. We talked about this earlier. This is the full cost of going to that college. Every family has an expected family contribution, or EFC. This is the amount of money that the college, that the government or the college says that you can afford. And when you take the differences between these two numbers, what you get is the need. And wouldn't you know, there's a lot of colleges that will just pay that need at 100%. A lot of colleges will do most of it. And some colleges don't. So if you come across a college that isn't going to pay your need, don't go there. And it's easy as asking, how much demonstrated need do you meet? Oftentimes this information is found on the college's website. So some schools will modify your need. This is really interesting because a lot of your college planners and admissions counselors will give you resources to look for outside scholarships. And what a lot of these people don't know is that oftentimes, if you go after scholarships that aren't paid for by the college, you could actually hurt yourself and reduce the money that the college ends up giving you. So I'm all for scholarships, but I want you to get scholarships. I want you to get money that's paid for by the college, not from some other outside organization. You have to know what your formula looks like before you even apply. Otherwise, you're just gonna be guessing like everybody else. Now, regardless of what your income is, if you know what your formula looks like, it's gonna go a long way in helping you understand the amount of money and the kind of money that you're gonna get from college. So how much aid is out there? According to the Department of Education, there's over $184 billion. And this chart is a little misleading because the government likes to include obscure tax credits that most families don't qualify for, includes loans. But if you're just looking at this chart and you want to understand where all the free money is coming from, there's a big chunk of money. I'd say more than half of the free money that's available doesn't even come from the government. It comes from the colleges themselves. Just to give you a quick example, Emory University here in Atlanta is sitting on a $6 billion endowment. And that's typical at a lot of elite schools. Their endowments are in the billions of dollars. I think Harvard has an endowment of over $40 billion. Now, your typical run-of-the-mill schools, private schools, maybe even a lot of private schools you've never heard of, sit on endowments in the hundreds of millions of dollars. That's the money you want. That's the money you want to go for. Let's look at this quick case study. Here's a family, $60,000 worth of income, $25,000 in college savings, $25,000 in regular savings, family of four, $50,000 of equity, and a rental property. Now, when the government looks at this, they're gonna tell this family that they can afford $19,000 a year, which is a third of their income, and that's ridiculous. So what we did was we taught this family a FAFSA strategy that cut their EFC by more than half. So my question to you is, which family would you rather be? Do you really just wanna wait until the government or the college tells you what your EFC is? Or should you find out what that number is right now and find out if that's a number that you can change? And I'll tell you what, families that do that don't just save a little, they save a lot on college. Let's talk about enrollment management. I've been teaching you enrollment management the entire time. Enrollment management, it started in the late 70s. It was taken from the airline industry. And think about it. If you ask 10 people on an airplane how much they paid for their ticket, you're gonna get 10 different answers. It's no different on a college, because when you ask 10 students on a college campus how much they paid to go to that college, you get 10 different answers. Enrollment management, it's a price, it's an optimization where colleges are making sure that as they price each seat, they're getting the most bang for their buck. And it's all about colleges making admissions, financial aid, and merit scholarship decisions that will increase their rankings. So like I said, if a college needs more students of a certain ethnicity, if they need more students of a certain major, if they need more students of a certain zip code, these are all things that drive rankings. When the rankings of a college go up, the amount of money they can charge on tuition, cost of attendance, that goes up as well. So they're basically spending money so that ultimately they'll generate more revenue. That's enrollment management. Think about it this way. Enrollment management is about what the college needs. But who cares about what the college needs? You have to focus on what your student needs and what your family needs. So how do we find that intersection where what the college needs actually intersects with what the family needs? Now, we found that intersection. Competition is the intersection. When you create competition, enrollment management starts working for you instead of against you. Again, competition between the colleges is what drives merit awards. This is an article in Forbes. You could access it through my download link. You should read it. It will blow your mind. It will really give you an insider's look into how colleges really think and why creating competition is an essential part of the college planning process. Now, this right here is a great podcast. I actually came upon this on accident back in 2012. And here on Planet Money, they're actually interviewing an enrollment manager. And it's amazing what this guy says on the podcast. He's basically spilling the beans. So I'm just gonna play for you a 40-second clip, but please visit the download link so you can listen to the complete podcasts. It's extremely enlightening.
So when Lafayette or Lehigh really wants to land a student, they have one very powerful tool. They offer the student a deal.
But they don't call it a deal. They call it a merit scholarship. Bob Massa, the guy I met in New York, says the only reason colleges offer merit scholarships is to compete with each other.
Families think that their sons and daughters are awarded a merit scholarship because of the fact that they're wonderfully smart and talented. And in fact, that's part of it. But the bottom line is the primary reason for awarding a non-need-based merit scholarship is to change a student's enrollment decision from another institution to our institution. That's why colleges do it.
This is Melinda, studying economics and law, 32 on the ACT. Initially wanted to go to UGA, like a lot of her friends, but she went through our selection process and we found 8 other colleges where she was elevated and an amazing fit. Now, what's interesting about this family is they made over $400,000 a year in annual income, and there were 3 people in their orbit already telling them they weren't gonna get any money for college. So the first person telling them was their accountant and CPA. They were basically saying, look, you're gonna get $0. The second person was their financial advisor saying, look, you make too much money, you're not gonna get money from these colleges. And the third person telling them was their own college planner. This family already had a college planner they were working with, and their college planner was telling them, yeah, there's not a lot of money out there for you. So they came to my class, they learned about enrollment management, and we said, you know what? You could get a lot of money from these colleges. So we went to work. So they had their house paid off, they had a big 529 plan, $250,000 in a brokerage account. But our FAFSA strategy allowed them to get more merit aid. So here was the result. Furman offered $25,000 a year in merit aid, which brought their cost from $62,800 down to $37,800 per year. Augustana offered $27,000 per year, which brought their cost of attendance from $52,700 down to $25,700, which is practically in-state price. Now, when you totaled the awards from all the colleges she applied to over 4 years, this family received over $500,000 in gift aid, okay? And again, this is what happens when you practice enrollment management instead of generic admissions counseling. Income, it's not the issue, okay? Competition is what drives merit awards, not necessarily income. Here's a low EFC family. This is Andre, 2018 grad, studying, wanting to major in computer science and economics. So 1350 on the SAT, we found 7 amazing colleges where he was elevated and an amazing fit. The family income was $86,000 a year. And I'll never forget what his dad told me. His dad said, look, I don't know why you're pointing us towards these really pricey colleges because we can't afford them. Kennesaw State's probably our only option. So I told this family that Kennesaw State was probably their most expensive option. So we went to work. Their initial EFC was 16.5. Our FAFSA strategy lowered their EFC down to 11.7. And here are the results. He was accepted into all the colleges, and Vanderbilt offered him $55,000 a year in grants, which brought their cost of attendance from 66.8 all the way down to their EFC of 11.7. It really works. So when you totaled all 7 of Andre's scholarship packages, he received over the 4 years over $1.2 million in gift aid. We did a really good job with that family. Now, sometimes you meet families whose EFCs can't be changed. So this was the case with Chris, liberal arts student, 1220 on the SAT. But so what? We're gonna create competition. We're gonna go after money from these colleges. Family income, $134,000 a year, $10,000 in assets, 34,000 EFC. So what was the result? Hiram offered an immediate award of $5,000. When he filed the FAFSA, Hiram could see on the FAFSA that he was also applying to College of Worcester, and they knew Worcester was giving out-of-state students $15,000. So when he submitted the FAFSA and they saw Worcester was on his list, they automatically tripled the offer. That's how colleges could see the other colleges they were competing with, was on the FAFSA form. And back in the day, we always told families that if you're gonna list colleges on the FAFSA, always list them in alphabetical order, because so many families make the mistake of listing their favorite college first. And when a college finds out that they're the favorite, they'll cut down the family's financial aid. Yeah, that really happens. So if you're ever asked to produce a list of colleges, whether it's on the FAFSA or if you're reporting scores from the SAT, ACT, always list your colleges in alphabetical order. Now, this here is a great article that you should take a look at. You can read it in the download link, and it's gonna give you some insight as to how a lot of these colleges really play dirty with how they award aid. So we've got to be smarter than that. About 5 years ago, the Department of Education finally put their foot down. They knew colleges were abusing the FAFSA by looking at the colleges that were listed there. So the federal government finally blocked that list. Again, they knew colleges were abusing that information, so they blocked it. Now, ever since that happened, a seismic shift occurred where colleges were no longer looking at the FAFSA to guess where the favorite colleges were. Guess where they're looking now? They're looking at social media. And if you think about it, how hard is it really to guess a student's favorite college based on what they're posting on social media? It's not that hard at all. And it's happening all over again. Families don't know what they're getting into. Colleges are at a supreme advantage. They're going through all this information, and when families show their hand and colleges realize that they're the top choice, merit aid gets taken off the table. So you really need to have a plan about this. We've been teaching this since 2014. We've actually had students like Matthew here featured on the New York Times, because it's just astonishing how much of an impact your social media has, and equally astonishing as to how many people in my field don't come near it or don't even teach this. So you gotta have a plan around this. Okay, last case study and we'll have you out of here. This is Alice, liberal arts degree, 1300 on the SAT. And she was looking at 15 colleges, but ultimately we got her focused on 7, where she was an amazing fit. Now, when you looked at this family and you looked at all the money they had, I'm thinking, wow, they should have enough money to pay for college. Why are they so nervous? And when I talked to them, I learned that that Alice had an older brother already going to Cornell. And they stroked that first check to Cornell to the tune of $43,000. Now, we realized, and they realized, that 3 more years of Cornell, all their money's gone, and that they would have to mortgage their house to pay for Alice's college. So we went to work. Their initial EFC of 42, we dropped it down to 27 with our FAFSA strategy. We also taught this family that when you have a second student in college, you can drop your EFC in half again. And we ultimately dropped it down to 15. We got Alice into Ursinus. Her merit award dropped the cost of that college to about $10,000 a year out of pocket. So great, now we're sending 2 students to college for what, $52,000, $53,000? No, because here's the deal. We knew that Cornell met need at 100%. And when we dropped their EFC down to 15, we changed their need. So we told them to go back to Cornell to see if they would change their award, and they did. So instead of paying 42 to $43,000 a year for one student, they're paying $30,000 a year for both students. That's enrollment management. These are the kinds of things that will drastically alter and change the course of a family's financial footprint and their ability to retire. And it will drastically change the kinds of schools your student can not only go to, but actually afford. So let's give you a few parting shots. Okay. I want to thank you all for coming, but I want you to think about a few things. What's your EFC going to be? Is it going to be high? Is it going to be low? Do you even want to know what your EFC is? All right. If you do, schedule a free FAFSA review. All right. Is there someone that you could talk to that will help you pick the right colleges? Is there someone that can talk to you about your specific situation? Absolutely. Get a free FAFSA review. It's no cost. If you thought you learned something today, what do you think we would learn one-on-one when we can see what the colleges are gonna see, all right? At the end of the day, do you wanna know if there is something on your FAFSA that's gonna hurt you? Let's find out what it is. Let's see if there's anything we can do to fix it, okay? So get a free FAFSA review, GameTheoryCollege.com/book. If you are gonna see me, keep in mind, there is no cost for this meeting. And if you're gonna see me, these are the things I need. I need you to get on my calendar. If you are married, I need both spouses present at this meeting. You could visit me at my office here in Sandy Springs in Aria, or you could set up an online go-to meeting, whatever your preference. If you're gonna see me, please get on my calendar in the next 2 to 3 weeks. If you set a date, I'm gonna send you a data packet. Fill out what you can. A data packet, think of it as a practice FAFSA. It's gonna allow me to see the things that the colleges are gonna see. Now, I've got an hour with you, and I wanna spend that entire hour teaching you instead of filling in a form for you. But it's your meeting. You could come with the information or not. It's completely up to you. And if you're gonna cancel on me, that's fine. Please give me a 24-hour notice. That gives me just enough time to make arrangements to put somebody else in that time slot. So GameTheoryCollege.com/book. I hope I get a chance to see each and every one of you. So thanks for coming and take care.